particular grace and peace from God, and in this time together, virtually, may we experience God's grace and peace through prayer and sermon and through song. And so we'll turn it over to Linda and Craig and Jamie, who are here with us this morning. Bruce is going to turn on Linda's microphone there, so we've got some ability to do some music, and Brandon's got the laptop, and we'll figure this out as we go. Facing our world, as we think of the challenges facing our lives, Lord, knowing that you are still in control, knowing that whatever anxiety and fear that we feel of the unknown at this time, that we might still know your blessings, that we still might know your peace, that we still might know your presence with us today and each day. And so be with us here, Lord, as we seek you together virtually, as we sing together, as we pray together, and as we hear from your word. May it penetrate our hearts that we might know your peace. It's in Jesus' name that I pray, and all God's people say, amen.
Just a few announcements. I'll get here so you can see me, and then we'll turn it back over to Mark, who's going to read the scripture. The building will still be closed. All of the preschool and Bridgewater school schedule this week. We're actually planning on virtual Easter services because it doesn't look like this is going to be a short thing. So keep your Facebook Live dates. 9:30 on Sunday mornings. Share the video if you can for your friends and neighbors. We're having a tremendous response. Last week, 1,000 views on the Facebook Live worship service. If you've been following on Facebook Live, you know that in the morning, I've been doing an immunobooster of faith. Pastor Mark's doing a family devotion in the early evening. From this week, from Monday, we'll have different women leaders, Sue McGee, Laura Cabral, Frank from Faith from the Hope House, Kathy Giannetti, who will be doing evening faith boosters on Facebook Live as well. So you can keep in touch with us there, and we'll keep trying to pour into you. We will give official updates as to when the building is back open on the website, on Facebook. So watch for that, but I don't expect it soon. Also, then, of course, this week, the Fireman's fundraiser has to be postponed. Stony Brook's restaurant is shut down. And would ask that you would continue to remember your neighbors around you, pray for them, reach out to them. Would ask that if anybody's in special need, let us know for the Deacon's Fund. If you can, if you're not affected as of yet financially, if you can help continue to support the church, we got to keep things going at nbrc.com/giving or Easter Outreach. We're going to be, rather than getting together and packing meals and delivering them, we're going to be giving amounts of money to the different groups that we work with for food, because those vulnerable populations are deeply affected right now. So look on our giving page, the Mission of the Month Easter Outreach. And then also, if you would like to contribute to Learning Gate, our adopted low-income daycare center, we're buying $25 gift certificates from ShopRite or Walmart. You don't have to buy the gifts. You can just send a check into the church, and that very vulnerable population will be helped as well. Give as you can. Thank you for who you are. And I want to especially thank, before we go back to the scripture and the sermon, I want to thank the staff, Mark and Linda. Doris came in every day last week when she was on vacation to keep this place running. Thankful for Jamie and Craig, volunteers, Bruce. Thankful for Brandon to do our technology. Everybody, the building and grounds people, finance people, the mission people who are keeping things going virtually. Thank you all. And let's continue to be the church that serves. Now, we hear from our scripture.
The scripture reading for today, we're going to bring to you from the Children's Bible. Those of you who have been following along with the evening family-friendly devotions, this will look familiar to you, or those of you who have maybe had one of these Bibles or still have one of these Bibles in your houses today. The scripture lesson is the story of the prodigal son, or the lost son, and it comes from Luke 15, verses 11 through 32. Listen for the word of our Lord. Now Jesus told another parable about God's love. There was a man who had two sons, said Jesus, and he owned a big farm. His youngest son did not want to work anymore. He wanted to travel and have fun, so he asked his father for his share of the family money. The son got the money, he packed his things, and left. He couldn't wait to see the world. His family was sad to see him go. At first, he had fun spending the money. He bought expensive clothes and he ate fancy food, but soon, all the money was gone. He had to go to work, and he got a job with a pig farmer. He was so hungry that even the pig's food looked good. The son wanted to go back home. He said, "I will tell my father I am sorry for what I have done. I do not deserve to be called his son. Maybe he will let me work for him." The father saw his son coming down the road, his eyes filled with tears as he ran to greet him. And the son said, "Please forgive me, Dad." That night, they had a big party. And the father exclaimed, "My son was lost, but now he's found." This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
So this Lent, we've been doing a series on meditation. And I want to talk about it from this standpoint. Actually, let me get a Bible here. The way we're going to learn to meditate today is in response to the fact that the Bible is a very distant book for men, right? It's a book that's very unfamiliar to our culture. When we do a discovery class, we have people who, we ask them to read the Gospel of Mark. They read the Bible for the first time. And it's so strange, because what was the background in the first century? Or what does Jesus mean when he said... And because it's unfamiliar, it feels sometimes like a very distant book. And we have to try to find a way to bring it close. Or, for those of us that were steeped in the church like myself, sometimes it's too familiar. So we hear the beginning of a story like, "There once was a man who had two sons," and our eyes glaze over because we've heard this story hundreds of times. So how do you take this very distant book and bring it close to you? I want to suggest a way of meditating that allows you to enter into the story. And here's how we do this. We identify with one character. And to do that, I'm going to use one of Rembrandt's famous paintings. If you're at home, you want to look this up, you can. It's Rembrandt, the prodigal son, and talk about each character as Rembrandt depicted him in this story. First, let's start with the younger son. Who's right here? We see the younger son, his head, his hair is shorn. Now, that was a disgrace in the ancient world, and that probably meant that maybe he had to sell his hair in order to just eat and to live. And we notice also in this painting that his clothes are very dirty. Matter of fact, we wouldn't know this, but in the 17th century, these clothes were really his underwear. He had sold the clothes off his back in order to eat and live after he had done the wine, women, and song. And then we notice his feet. Shoes fallen off there. Sole has fallen off. Shoes are very worn. And we realize that this story where the young son was having a great time ended poorly for him, and he had to come back. So what is it about him? I'm indebted this morning to Henry Nouwen's meditations on this story called The Return of the Prodigal. And he describes the younger son, in light of Rembrandt's painting, as one who's always chasing but never finding. Do you identify with that? You're always looking for something, but you never seem to find it. Or maybe you identify that you had a time in your life or a time now when you were rebellious or willful or prideful and didn't need anybody's help and didn't care if there was a God out there and didn't need God if he was. We've all had times like that. You know, I was an agnostic in college because I couldn't handle the religion I grew up with. I was thumbing my nose in a way at God. Is that where you are? We can think of in our present pandemic that there are some people who don't care about the rules and social distancing and are out partying or spring breaking or just ignoring because for whatever reason. So many people in parks yesterday that we had to work hard when we were walking in the park to stay 6 feet away from everybody. Maybe there's a willfulness there. It's going out, actually. Yeah, well, I'm letting the conference call people know. They've heard.
I'm not a North Branch member, so I won't let me comment. I can only like it.
Oh, really?
My request
I can
is
comment.
Oh, really?
Yes.
How did we do that? Send a new request, we'll approve.
I did this morning.
You don't want to look and see if that other thing that she was talking about was the thing? She said it was a box.
Yeah, I saw one thing that was next to her laptop.
Looks like it's coming up now. All right, we're going to try this again. We were at the younger son, always running, always chasing, never finding, right? Where is that like you? Where is that like me? Where do we identify with that? One way to meditate. Then let's look at the elder son. The elder son of Rembrandt's painting, and again, if you're at home, you can Google Rembrandt's Return of the Prodigal. We have, let me go over to the elder brother. Notice he's standing far away. Notice he's looking down. Let me see, I can look at how I get to him. Looking down on his brother. Notice that his hands there are kept to himself. He's not reaching out to him. And the elder brother is the one now, it says, is always dutiful, never enjoying. He resents the fact that his younger son could spend his inheritance and run away and have all this fun and then come home and still be received and still get a party. And he says, I have worked hard for you always, and I'm upset that I can't, that you never gave a party to me. And so sometimes we're resentful. Sometimes we're like the older brother. You know, I'm a professional older brother. You pay me to judge you. You pay me every week to tell you that you don't quite measure up, right? And I do the elder brother thing naturally. Last night, we have Chris and Tyler down, so we had a family table full, and they started a theological discussion. And in your household, if I was there, you might look to me and I might say, well, in my experience, or I believe Jesus meant this or said this or whatever. In my house, I gotta shut up. Why? Because I've said too much in the past. Matter of fact, they looked at me like, are you gonna judge us for what we're saying or what we're thinking? And I said, well, I could leave the room. We laughed. I just kept quiet. And they had a great discussion thinking about who God is and all of this sort of stuff and how do they figure that out? Because I've been the elder brother too much. Maybe you have too. The world's view of the church is that we judge and we're judgmental. And the church has been the elder brother too much. Has that happened to you? Or last, are you the younger brother? Are you the older brother? Or are you in Rembrandt's painting? Let me get it here. The welcoming father. He portrays the father as blind. Can't quite see. But although he may be physically blind, he's spiritually able to see. And he sees that his younger son needs love and forgiveness. And so he, in that Dutch restrained way, wraps his arms around him. And then you see this red cape. It's called the red cape of forgiveness, and it just touches on his shoulder over here. And now one points out that the hands look different. One hand looks nurturing, like a mother's hand. The other hand looks strong. I can't quite figure out how it is. Here we go. Other hand looks strong, like a father's hand. And maybe this is the way that God is like father and mother to us, empowering and nurturing, accepting and loving, and the father is the hero of the story. We're all to become like the welcoming Father. That's the God figure, the Christ figure in the story. And isn't that who we're called to be? Aren't we called to love and to accept and to nurture and to empower and be in that position more than in the judgmental position? I believe that's true. I believe that's true of me. The last time we were able to get together was March the 8th, 2 weeks ago, and it might be the last time for a while. And the highlight of that service, if you were there, or if you watched, you couldn't watch it live back then because we only video sermons, but if you were there, the highlight was that Kelly Neuberger did a children's message with her autistic son, Luke. And if you remember, Kelly sat here, and Luke paced in front of the kids over there, and Luke is our friend who dances in the aisles during the music. Matter of fact, Kelly last week posted on the Facebook Live that Luke was in the other room, and when he heard Linda and the music began, he ran into the room because his music was playing. And Kelly talked so beautifully about the fact that, yeah, Luke has special needs, but we all have special needs. Luke has special strengths, and we all have special strengths. Luke's strength is compassion, his love of music. He can communicate through his iPad, though he can't communicate verbally. And we listened, and we were in awe, and we loved it. And to me, that's North Branch at its finest. That's North Branch as the welcoming Father, who sees weaknesses in me, and weaknesses in you, strengths in you, and strengths in me, and somehow allows those weaknesses to be empowered in God's love and those strengths and to be forgiven in God's love and empowered in God's love. And somehow those strengths come together, and as a family, we're able to get through things. And that's what we're going to need in this pandemic. We're going to need mothers who are going crazy, working from home and doing homeschooling to reach out and get help from a friend. It's going to have to be you checking on your friends and neighbors. It's going to have to be us being patient with each other when we've been together for too long. We're going to have to find a way to come together. Your strengths and my weaknesses, my strengths and your weaknesses, and the welcoming Father bringing us all together. That's who we are. That's what we're going to need more than ever in the weeks to come. Let's pray. Welcoming Father, welcome us back into your presence. Forgive us when we've been rebellious and foolish. Forgive us when we've been judgmental and condescending and resentful. We're grateful. We love you. We celebrate your presence. And we celebrate each other. Help us in this time. In your name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. So now, I'm going to unmute the folks that are on the call and take any prayer requests from you first. Do you have any prayer requests that you want to add? We'll do Thanksgivings first. Some Thanksgivings or concerns. We'll do them together, and I'll repeat. Jesus, we thank and ask you for. Share any from the conference call, and then we'll go to the Facebook Live folk. Any Thanksgivings or concerns from our conference call folks? Okay, we're praying for a very close friend, son-in-law. This friend's son-in-law is medically not doing well and not expected to live. We pray for him. Other Thanksgivings and concerns. Other Thanksgivings or concerns? Okay. All right, the conference call is having trouble with the audio, so I'm going to mute them again, and we'll go to the Facebook Live, folks.
All participants are muted, and they can unmute themselves.
All right, what do we have in prayer concerns? We thank the Lord for the virtual ability to be together. This is someone that lives in the Netherlands. We pray for those who have lost their income. And we had a prayer request this morning that came to us by text. That, let's see if I can find it. Asking special prayers for all healthcare workers. This is from Sherry Minchin, like herself and Abby, who are and will be working around those infected with the coronavirus to help keep us ourselves safe and healthy so we may take care of others. Also asking for community and those businesses who use N95 masks, surgical gloves, and other protective gear to donate to your local hospitals, such as Hunterdon Medical Center, Morristown, Somerset, Robert Wood Johnson Hospitals, so all the healthcare workers can stay safe and healthy during the coronavirus outbreak. Are there any others? Which one did you? Thank you, God, for the ability to worship together this morning. I pray for Dick Wharton, who had his knee surgery and is recovering at home. All right, I think that's our prayer concerns and thanksgivings. Let's say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever and ever.
Don't matter.